Okay, well, thank you. For those of you who don't know me, I'm Claudia Payne. I'm the library director, and this is a joint program with the Salisbury Association. I'm here to do housekeeping. The thing you're probably all wondering is, why do you have these tickets? And the reason you have these tickets is because we want to do our best to make sure that we have programs that you like. So this is your way of telling us if you like something, if you don't like something, if you're just neutral. So there are three boxes over there by the for sale by the books for sale table. Well, number one is, I really loved it. Please have more programs like this. Number two is neutral. You know, doesn't really matter to me one way or the other. And number three is, I really wish I hadn't come. And I know none of you will put a ticket in that box, but you know, this is something new that we're doing so that we can have programs that you want. And other housekeeping, there are exits. The door you came in, and there's an exit over there, and we have a restroom on this floor. It's down the hall, all the way to the end, and on the left. And so thank you for coming. I'll turn this over to George for the introduction.
Thanks a lot for coming. Good morning. I'm George Massey of the Salisbury Association Land Trust. We're very happy to be cooperating with the library in these talks. The Salisbury Association also cooperates with the library with some history talks. And in fact, there's one of them coming next Saturday. It's going to be Dick Paddock talking about this cannon, which the Salisbury Association recently acquired. And is this a Salisbury cannon, or is it a cannon like a Salisbury cannon? So today we have the Sherlock Holmes of the forest, and next week you'll be able to come and hear the Sherlock Holmes of the iron industry and cannons. Dick Paddock is an incredible speaker. He's really an outstanding historian. He's also a scientist himself, so you're going to get a lot of good information. Those people that have heard Dick, you will be sure they come, and those that haven't heard him, do come. He knows an enormous amount, and he's got an enjoyable kind of storytelling format, which makes it enjoyable as well. Then we have a little bit of complication here today, because we're bringing a lot of people and we're parking them along Route 44. And so where we're going today for the walk, if you go east out to Main Street, go right up 44 east towards Canaan, come to the flashing light at the Taconic Road, three-tenths of a mile further is where you're going to be parking on the left. There'll be somebody there to guide you. But I have done just a little schematic to kind of help get the picture. So here we are heading east. Here's Salisbury School up here. So we can get about 10 cars in this way, nose in, but they should go far in, so that we leave 20 feet behind him, because when we leave, under no circumstances should anybody be backing into Route 44. There are cars coming around here at 50, 60 miles an hour. So before you leave, make sure you're turned around, and whichever way you want to go, that you're driving straight out, not backing out into the road. We're trying to carpool people here in, with at least three in a car. I'll kind of organize that a bit during the 11:30 to 12 lunch. If you, for whatever reason, are going with fewer than three, you should head up here to the overflow parking. Another tenth of a mile beyond here is the first driveway into Salisbury School. It's well before you get to the school. There's a number 241 out there. And if you go in there 150 feet, there'll be room to park on the grass alongside that drive. But if we carpool successfully, we'll be able to get most people up here, and we'll help you park. Oh, and as you go to park, don't get caught halfway across the road. Stay in your travel lane until you're sure where you're going, because the visibility behind you is dandy. This visibility is terrible. And so people, this is the real danger here. Make sure that you don't get stuck in the middle of this road, because there's some confusion here. And you're okay to hang out in your travel lane until you know where you're going. And if you're up here, there's a mowed path, actually. No thanks to me, but it's nice that it's there. So if you cross the road here, you've got a mowed grass path well off the road. It will get you down to the entrance here. When you're parking here, the entrance is just 50 feet further east.
A couple of us will be standing there. and pointing. So we're not hitchhiking.
So this,
we'll try to help out.
This is a picture of the cannon in our most recent newsletter, and I'll also point out to you, you can get these at the Academy Building today, tomorrow, and then, what are the next, and then October 4th and 5th are these historic walks by the North Housatonic Heritage Walks. And these are all great walks as well. Yeah, our guest today is Tom Wessels. He's an ecologist, founding director of a master's degree program in conservation biology at Antioch University, New England. He is the current chair of the Center for Whole Communities that fosters inclusive communities, strongly rooted in place, and where all people have access to and healthy relationship with the land. That's something we all have to work to cultivate, because we are not going to have successful environmental programs going forward if all of our citizens don't have to enjoy the benefits of the land and understand it. Tom has conducted landscape level workshops throughout the country for 30 years now. He's really a nationally renowned figure. He was no victim of nature deficit disorder, although he grew up in a suburban area. His lot abutted 70 acres of forest, which was his playground through his grammar school years. And we might guess that that set him on his life track. As a college student, he was challenged by his professor to explain why this forest was different than this forest, when they were seemed to be more or less in the same place. And that, again, is a launch of understanding what's going on in a forest. And we're going to get a lot of the benefit of his lifetime of study today. So he's an educator of the best kind. There's nothing better, I think you know, than when you see something and then have the opportunity to go out and see it on the land. And that's what we're going to have today. And there really is no more enjoyable or better way to learn than this format which Tom has established. And of course, this will be looking at both ecology and history. These are the impacts. So every forest has a story. Tom is going to help us figure out how to learn and hear that story. Around here, the earth grows plants, and unless there's a farmer on board or a Native American doing a burning regimen, these plant communities tend to grow into forests. But it isn't certain what kind of a forest it'll get, and it's no straight line route to any particular ending. So there's lots of ways for these things to move around on their way. And after today, we hope all of your walks in the forest will be a little different than they've been before, and they'll be a little bit richer and more valuable for you. And remember that tree that fell in the forest, and no one was there to hear it? We'll go out today and we'll see if we can hear the echo. I'm very happy to put you in the capable hands of Tom Wessels.
That's a very, very nice introduction, and I should say I'm really pleased to be here because although my school portion of the year was down in coastal Connecticut, I spent my summers right here in Salisbury on Twin Lakes, and actually my cousin Ted there, and his wife Donna, owned the cottage that our great-grandfather got up there in the 1920s, so I know the area well. I've spent lots of time here, and I'm really pleased to be back. So what we'll do is we'll look at the evidence that we can use to interpret past agricultural histories in now forested landscapes. And I think we'll have time in the slide portion to actually get into interpreting logging histories in forested landscapes. And that'll give us a more than enough material to go out and apply out in the field. Now, there's a lot of information in the slide program. If you have questions, please ask them as we're going through the slides. There'll certainly be time for questions at the end as well. And I'll have some questions for you. These won't be rhetorical. I'll be expecting you to try to figure things out. The problem with the sequencing of my questions is the first two are the most challenging. And they're pretty challenging questions. And it's not that I'm trying to stump you right off the bat, it's just the way the material unfolds. But after that, the questions become much more manageable. It's like yes or no, which means if you're brave, you have a 50% chance of getting it correct right off the bat. And even if you get the wrong answer, you've actually given us the correct answer. So be brave. I'm going to stay on the first slide longer than the rest because I want to set the historical stage for the agricultural history of, basically, we're right on the edge of the region that I'm going to be focusing on in here in Salisbury, but it really very much impacted the Berkshire County of Massachusetts dramatically. So I'm going to take some time to set that stage because that had a big influence on what we see around here. So I will get to the slides, and I guess we can probably hit the lights. A little bit dark in here. So this is a map from Green Forested Landscape that shows the three major forested zones in New England. Northern New England up here in gray, central New England in white, and then southern New England down here in gray. And really, in Salisbury, we're right on this cusp between central and southern New England. Now, southern New England is really the northern reaches of the temperate deciduous forest biome. That's a forested biome that stretches all the way down to the Gulf States across the Mississippi River, historically dominated by American chestnut. And we're going to get into that story today. It is in the field. We're going to come across remnants of American chestnut. But today, throughout much of the rain, dominated by species of oaks. Northern New England is the southern reaches of the coniferous boreal forest biome. That's a biome that stretches up into Labrador, out across a bunch of Canada and the northern tier of the United States, dominated by coniferous trees like black spruce, white spruce, and larch. And then sandwiched in between is central New England. And by the way, this zone doesn't end right at the border here with New York. Matter of fact, a lot of New Yorkers say, "What, you know, what's going on here?" So, but it's just that my publisher wanted to focus on New England, so the map came out this way. But this is often called the transition forest because it's the major mixing zone of the two major forested biomes in eastern North America. So if you like biotic diversity, this is a great place to be because we get that mixing. And there's two real hot spots in terms of that mixing. One is the Housatonic River Valley, right in this region right here. The other is the Champlain Valley. These two areas have the highest species richness of plants pretty much anywhere in the Northeast. So this is a really fantastic place to be. But central New England is also different from southern and northern New England, because this is the part of New England that was visited by sheep fever. And if you've never heard of sheep fever, let me tell you, the sheep were absolutely fine. There was nothing wrong with them. The fever was a wool-growing mania that's been compared to a religious fanaticism. And it dramatically transformed the central portion of New England in about a three-decade time frame. Now, what sparked sheep fever, interestingly enough, is Napoleon going to war against Spain in 1806. Now, it might sound odd that a war in Europe can dramatically impact New England landscapes, but the Spanish had developed a special breed of sheep called the Merino. And this was not just a hardy animal that made a robust fleece, but the fleece made very fine, non-scratchy woolen. So if you have any smart wool garments, that's all made out of Merino wool. Now, the Spanish were very smart. They literally exported those woolen textiles they produced to the Old World and the New World, but they had an embargo on the sheep itself. They did not want anyone to get a hold of that breed, become a competitor with them. Well, because of Napoleon going to war with Spain, they had trouble enforcing the embargo. And it happens that in 1810, the United States Council of Portugal was a Vermonter. He lived right there in Wethersfield, Vermont, the Connecticut River. And in 1810, he was able to smuggle 4,000 Merino sheep out of Spain to Portugal. Now, quite a bit of smuggling, but in any case, he brought them back to his Vermont farm, and now Merinos are in New England. 2 years later, we went to war with Britain, and one result of the War of 1812 is that tariffs went up on all imported woolens, giving a market advantage, anyone who could make woolen textiles here. And then 2 years later, in 1814, the power loom was invented, which allowed now mass industrial production of textiles. With all the water power coming out of these central New England hills, it vaulted this region to become basically the wool textile manufacturing region of the world. Now, to give you an idea how dramatic the changes that could come with this are, in 1810, when Jarvis brings over those first 4,000 Merino sheep, only about 20% of this area in white is open agricultural land. So about a fifth. 35 years later, at the very peak of the sheep fever craze, Those 4,000 Renos have swelled to over 5 million in the region. In this area now is 80% open agricultural land. I mean, 60% of this whole area here was cut in just about a period of 3 decades, all to make way for pastures for sheep. So in this region, all the stone walls and woodland stone fences we see, if they're not estate walls that were built later, in the later 1800s, but all the stuff we see out in the woods around here, all those stone fences date back to the sheep fever craze. They're all built between roughly 1810 and the 1840s. In central New England, it's estimated there's over 125,000 miles of those woodland stone fences. So if we line them all up, they wrap around the equator 5 times. They've stretched more than halfway to the moon. I've calculated if all that rock was piled, it'd be 7 times as massive as all the pyramids in Egypt. And it was all done in just 3 decades. Now, if we were on the Mediterranean, these stone fences would undoubtedly be the 8th wonder of the world, but we're not. It's just an interesting part of our landscape history. Now, in their zeal to grow as much wool as possible, hillside farms were dramatically overgrazed, eroded. Farm productivity is dropping. At the same time, the Ohio Valley had been opened by the Erie Canal and rail, and all of a sudden cotton was coming in, and by the middle 1840s, those three things coming together just doomed the sheep fever craze, and it went bust. Between 1845 and 1855, Vermont and the western side of Massachusetts, in that decade, they both lost 1/2 their human residents. Basically, in Vermont, 125,000 Vermonters left and went out to Ohio. They took their sheep with them. They let their farmhouses and barns rot back into the ground. And then the wool was brought back by canal and rail to be processed in all the mill towns that have grown up here in central New England. Why? Because their farms were now very unproductive due to erosion, and the Ohio Valley were these rich, unglaciated, rock-free soils. And that was a real draw. I've often wondered if this country had been colonized from the west coast coming east, and people came across all those amazing soils through the plain states, and then started working their way up into here, and got into our glaciated soils in the northeast, they just sort of stopped and say, okay, we'll just let that be national park or something. So once the draw was, they could go to these soils that were free of rocks, they're going to rush to them. So that's the reason. Now, it's also a great story of recovery. In many parts of the world where sheep overgrazed the landscape, basically forests did not return. There's huge swaths in the Mediterranean. Iceland was originally a forested island, or little, you know, I guess it's bigger than an island, whatever it is. But today, Iceland has basically 1 square mile of forest. That's their national forest. Due to overgrazing by sheep, luckily here, our soils and I think our climates made our system more resilient, and our forests returned. So this is an image of Mount Monadnock in southwestern New Hampshire from Pitcher Mountain. These two mountains are linked by the Monadnock Sunapee Greenway. That is a hiking trail that if you hike through today, you'll trip across stone wall after stone wall after stone wall after stone wall. Because pretty much everything in the slide we see was open pasturage as of 1840. And now it's predominantly forested. Question?
Were the stone walls used to confine each farmer's sheep, or were they used as boundaries?
No, they were not. I mean, they sometimes ran around farm boundaries, certainly. But there was no need to build a stone wall to mark a boundary. You can mark a boundary by putting stakes in or flagging trees. Whenever you see stone fences, they were utilitarian for keeping animals in pastures or out of crop fields or hay fields. So this is another view, I'm just going to focus this a bit, in central New England. This is over in Pownal, Vermont, sort of north of us here by about 60 miles on Route 7. I've hiked in this section of the Taconic Range here behind this farm, which is crisscrossed by stone walls, in some cases rising to the ridgetop and going over. In those areas, you'll find broad expanses of bedrock where overgrazing by merino sheep eroded everything right down to the bedrock materials.
Excuse me, I thought the stone walls were also built so that the land could be farmed, and that basically a farmer would, you know, run his hoe through the land and move the rock to the side.
The material for making the stone walls did come out of the land that was being worked agriculturally, but farmers preferred wood fencing. They could put up 10 times as much split rail wood fencing out of oak or chestnut, which is abundant around here, than they could stone. So all the original fencing around here, if we were here in the 1700s, we wouldn't see stone walls. It was all wood. But with the massive deforestation associated with sheep fever, there is no longer enough wood. They'd go back to stone dumps where all that rock had been dumped over embankments, bring it back, and build stone fences to replace the wooden fences. So, yeah, these stone fences weren't built as the land was opened up. They come after the land was opened up.
Tom, when you talk about pasture, you talk about grass, you're talking about shrubs, you're talking about just cut the trees.
Well, to make pasture, what they would have done around here, they would have cut the trees. Around here, probably some of that wood was going for charcoal production. As you get further away, you know, to the east, where you didn't have good iron ore or limestone, it was all going into potash. It was just being burned and sold and shipped over to Europe. And that was a pretty good cash crop. Farmers back, you know, in the 1700s, early 1800s, were getting about $4.50 an acre on potash. So the original pastures would have just been whatever forage was there, the stump sprouts coming from the hardwood trees, the livestock would eventually kill off all those stump sprouts, denude the land, then it would be seeded, so they didn't stump it or anything. They just seed it around the stumps, and eventually the stumps would rot away, and that's how these pastures started.
They actually seeded that.
They would seed in once the vegetation's denuded. Yeah, there's really a question in the back.
I was just going to sort of add that because of the erosion, the rock and the frost, the rocks kept popping up, and to have more grazing, didn't they keep piling the rocks on the fences?
Yeah, so yeah. The rocks kept coming out of the ground. We'll get into that a little later, explain why. And so as they did, you know, the stone fences were built, but then sometimes there was more rock coming out. Often where two stone fences came together, they'd start filling in the corners. If there were any ledge areas nearby, they'd pile it up on ledges, so it could get piled all sorts of different places. Now, this slide also shows the three major reasons the land was open for agricultural activity. One reason was to put in a crop field, like this hay field here, where the ground was plowed annually and seeds were sown. The second reason was to put it into hay field over here to grow forage for livestock in the winter. And then the third reason was to put them in pasturage, like this area up here. And that's not just a pasture. That's an overgrazed pasture. And I can tell that by the type of vegetation encroaching that site. Now, with good pasture management, where you're doing very intensive grazing over short periods of time and a lot of rotation of your livestock, you can maintain very productive pastures for centuries. But if a pasture is overgrazed, when that happens, that means that livestock are staying in one place, grazing, 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 and only on the preferred plants, letting other plants come in they don't prefer. Around here, if you get overgrazing like that, those sites will grow right back up the forest on their own, and then they go through four very classic successional phases, which we'll get into in a bit because they'll start giving us some good evidence to work with. So this is what it looked like around here as of probably 1840. 80% of the landscape cleared. Of course, this would be below 2,000 feet, so the Taconic Range over here would have been mostly forested. But outside the Taconic Range, about 80% of the landscape cleared, 20% being left in woodlot. And those woodlots were critical for the growing of fuel wood. Back during the sheep fever period, globally, we were still in little ice age climates. And also with the massive deforestation, there was dramatic radiational cooling on winter nights. So generally, nighttime temperatures back then were going about 25 degrees colder than we see today during the winter. So if you're a year-round resident or in this area, I'd ask you to think about what were the temperatures you saw in your thermometer last winter? Drop them down 25 degrees. Imagine you're living in an uninsulated, drafty farmhouse, and your only source of heat are open fireplace hearths. You start to think, wow, I'd be burning a lot of wood, and they did burn a lot of wood. Around here, small farmhouses were burning about 25 cords of wood a year, and large ones up to 70. So they needed some of their land just in woodlot, but with the massive deforestation from sheep fever, there's no longer enough wood to replace zigzag split fences, split rail fences. They rot away, and the stone fences replace them. Yeah.
Are those fences meticulously built, or are they just piling up stone?
It depends on the farmer. the quality of the fence work. Some farmers built very meticulous fences, others just piled it and then it would come down and repile it. But I should mention, there are also areas that you just had stone dumps along the edge of agricultural lands. They weren't trying to make it into a fence, they're just dumping it there. But if you see actually rocks that are intentionally being stacked in any way, that was fencing that was being built up. But again, depended on the farmer, how fastidious they were about the quality of the fence building. So back then, in central New England, it was sheep that were creating all these landscape changes. And yet, until very recently, here in New England, maybe, you know, only a decade or so ago, if we were to think about market farming in New England, we'd be thinking about dairy farming. Of course, in the last, you know, 10, 15 years, we've seen a real diversification of our farm sector here in New England. We're getting many, many small farms, specialty farms, growing produce, livestock, all sorts of things. But whether it's cows or sheep, if a pasture is overgrazed, as I mentioned, it's going to revert back to forest, and it's going to go through four classic phases in that process. And this is what the first phase looks like. The first thing you'll notice in overgrazed pasture is that the grasses have been reduced and replaced by a lot of broadleaf plants who have their leaves growing at ground level in a radial fashion. That growth form there is called a basal rosette. So that's the first sign a pasture's been overgrazed. The grasses are reduced, basal rosettes move in. Now in this slide, plants that have that basal rosette growth form are hawkweeds, pussy toads, sheep sorrel, yarrow. I should mention all four of those species, plus 95% of the plants you can find along around here that have the basal rosette growth form, they are not native plants to the New World. They all came from the Old World, because this was a growth form selected for in Old World pastured landscapes. Now, if you're a plant and you're going to survive in an actively grazed pasture, you have one of three strategies you can employ. You can be armed with spines or thorns, you can be unpalatable, but if you're neither of those, you better hug the ground to stay with the mouth of the cow sheep to go. So again, when you're out your lawn, you see plantains, things like that, they're all from the Old World. Now, a lot of those plants got here by accident. So when the British first came to New England, one of the things that really caught their fancy were groves in ravine tributaries coming into our major rivers where white pine could grow to 230 feet in height and up to 8 feet in diameter. These were mammoth trees. Now, they only grew in those settings because they had to be tucked down into the landscape where forests at the top of the ravine would protect their crown from windstrike or lightning throw. Because these trees could grow a good 100 feet taller than everything else. When the British saw those pines, they thought, my goodness, what sort of naval ships could we make with those being the masts? So they built special boats called mast boats. These boats were designed to carry 20 to 30 180-foot long white pine logs back to London to be made into masts. So they had an aft that would open so you could slide the logs in. But because they're designed to carry so much weight, often they had to be filled with ballast on the voyage from London to New England. The ballast was usually in the form of cobbles, but if they weren't available, it would just be earth. And those ships would come into port, the earth would be excavated onto the harbor side to make way for the logs, and in it were the seeds of these plants that germinated, and to their delight, had, you know, often windblown seeds that blew inland. And what did they find? Perfectly prepared, overgrazed landscapes, which was just what they were adapted for. And I should mention, that's how our earthworms got here, too. Earthworms are not native to this region. They all came in the ballast of those mast ships as well. Now, in amongst these basal rosettes, we start to get little areas of exposed soil where there's no longer any thatch from the grass. That becomes the germination site for the next group of plants to move in, which are coarse weeds, which grow upright as these things are doing in here. And they can do this because they're usually armed with spines, like the thistle. And I should mention, the majority of plants we see in the region today, the spines and thorns, are not natives. Again, most of them coming from the Old World, where this was a strategy they developed in Old World pastured landscapes. And most of these plants that come in this phase have small windblown seeds. And the seeds are so small that to successfully establish, they have to land on bare soil. If they land on a thatch of grass, they would not have enough energy to germinate and get root down through that. So the thinning of the grasses and removing of the thatch and allowing the basal rosettes to come in also allows germination sites for these coarse weeds. which do include some native species. The milkweed is a native species. But you'll notice that's a fairly sizable seed. And that's because the native habitat of the milkweed were intervales along our major rivers, like the Housatonic here. There would have been intervales lining the Housatonic, and intervales were prairie-like grasslands. And these intervales were the result of Native American agriculture, where they grow, you know, their maize, beans, and squash from those nutrient-rich, rock-free alluvial soils next to our major rivers. And eventually those garden plots would lose productivity. That was not a big deal. They just abandoned, open up another site. But the abandoned sites would be burned annually to keep them in prairie-like vegetation, because eventually the soil would rejuvenate. It was much easier removing sod to put in a new garden site than having to get out new trees and shrubs. So basically 600 years of this activity pushed the forest margins back from our major rivers, in some cases up to a half a mile. Now, and that would have been the native habitat of milkweed, which needed a large seed to successfully inhabit those prairie-like systems. Now, when we came down here to do this program, we left now we live in New Hampshire, but we crossed into Vermont to do this in Dowda. But we came down Interstate 91 from Vermont, and we entered the Pioneer Valley, Massachusetts. And we drove by Northfield, Massachusetts, then Greenfield, then Deerfield, then Hatfield. When we approached Springfield, we got on the Mass Pike, but we kept going. We'd gone through Springfield and entered Enfield, Connecticut. And it's not just an accident that all those towns in the Pioneer Valley and in Field, because when the British got up there in the 1600s, that's what they saw lining the rivers, were fields on both sides stretching back almost a half a mile. Now, in these areas where these coarse weeds grow somewhat densely, they act as nurseries for the invasion of the third group of plants, which are the berry-producing shrubs. And now we have to rely on wildlife to get the seeds in the pasture. So it may be berry-eating mammals like foxes, coyotes, raccoons, more likely berry-eating birds like cedar waxwings or starlings or robins. But in either case, wildlife needs to defecate the seeds into clumps of coarse weeds if these berry-producing shrubs are going to establish. Now, as we'll see, a lot of these shrubs are armed with spines and thorns, because a lot of them are exotics from the old world. So this is Japanese barberry. You can't see the spines in the slide, but anyone's worked with this knows how spiny it is. Here's the hawthorn with its big, noticeable thorns. And you might think that plants like this could successfully colonize and actively graze pasture on their own, and yet they can't. They need to start in a clump of coarse weeds where they're hidden from view for a couple of years, because it often takes them up to 2 years to develop a thorn that is woody enough to deter the mouth of a browsing animal. So if they grow up out in the open, they often get browsed out of existence their first year. But if they're lucky enough to start off in some coarse weeds where they're hidden from view for a couple of years, it gives them the requisite woodiness to establish. And this can include a whole host of roses, in this case Fragosa rose, but more commonly Multiflora rose. And then eventually, these berry-producing shrubs become nurseries for the invasion of trees. So here we have a clump of barberry and rose, out of which is growing a white ash. And it's very unlikely that only one seed of a white ash tree fell in this pasture. I'm guessing white ash seeds fell back there, maybe over there. We don't see trees in those spots because they grew up out in the open. But this seed was lucky enough to land this clump of spiny, thorny shrubs where it was protected, and now it's reached a height where the dairy cows in this pasture can no longer get at it. So that's the way this process goes.
The thorny and all the invasive barberry that multiplied, have been here 200 years?
No, they've been here less than that. Sadly to say, a lot of these plants were brought over by the Audubon Society in the early 1900s for food for birds, not understanding the culture. So they've really only been here about a century, and they've really only become problematic, really, in the last maybe 40 years. I mean, I remember growing up here in Connecticut being told, don't pick, you know, Eurasian bittersweet, that's protected. I don't know, I mean, that's, I think that's a myth, but I mean, that's what we're told, and of course, now we can see what Eurasian bittersweet has become, and it's It's a scary space.
So in the 1820s, 30s, there were other native plants?
There were native plants, and you probably would have had a less of a concomitant of the shrubs in there happening. So this, what I'm pointing out here, is more or less what we're seeing happening today with pasture available. So you're right, these invasives wouldn't have been probably on site at those times. Just contemplate, trying to figure it out.
What, do you have examples of what were here that filled those same roles in the succession?
It's a good question. I'm guessing the successional pattern might have been different. I'm not sure what shrubs of ours, native species, can play the role of these exotics play. Because we just didn't have that many that were spiny or thorny or unpalatable. There was no selection pressure to deal with grazing pressures like that. I'm not sure what the pattern would have been back then.
But if you took the farms away and sent them out west, then it would just happen.
Then yes, and that's a different process. So this is actually a successional process that's happening while the pasture is being actively grazed. The farmer is basically losing it through time, even though the cows or sheep are out there. But what that pattern would have been like before these exotics got here, I'm not sure. I really don't know. Yeah.
During the period of all the sheep raising, were the coyotes and other animals preying on them, and how were they?
They were pretty much already extirpated. So pretty much by the time we get to 1800 around here, all predators are gone. Right? And first of all, coyotes were never native here. They filled the niche of the eastern timber wolf. So but the timber wolves would have been gone, mountain lions would have been gone, bobcats would have been gone, fisher was gone, anything that could be a larger predator was gone. Already by 1800.
There were eastern buffalo. Were they this far north?
They were this far north, but not this far east. So they did make it into western New York. That's why we have Buffalo, New York. They didn't make it this far to the east.
But you had the, not reindeer, but the forest elk or something?
We had caribou.
Caribou.
Caribou probably didn't quite make it down this far into Connecticut, but they certainly were up in portions of Vermont, New Hampshire, Maine would have had a lot of caribou. Yeah.
And you had moose?
Moose would have been around too, and moose would have been certainly down here in the sheep fever craze if there was enough forest land to support them. Of course, there probably wasn't, but climate conditions were much more conducive for moose being in Connecticut back then than they are today, because they're very sensitive to warmth during the winter time. They really struggle with it. So they need cold winter climates for moose to be successful.
What made all the predators that you listed to see them?
People. To get rid of them. People did not like predators, so they're all killed off.
You mentioned that bittersweet and looking for a rose weren't as much of a problem until about 40, 50 years ago.
Right.
Do you know what changed?
Well, it's part of the ecology we're still trying to understand. A lot of these invasives were around for a long time, but didn't show invasive tendencies right away. And then all of a sudden, I guess it's like you reach a critical mass of a seed load or something, and boom, they take off. And also, in a place like Connecticut, associated with that would be really lack of hunting pressure on deer, so the deer really increased. And then they removed the natives, making it even easier for the exotics to take off. So it's probably a combination of both building up seed load and then also seeing really built up deer populations. Now, another plant that comes in this third phase is this one right here. This next slide is a close-up of it. And I should mention, I took this photograph the summer of 1976. That's just about 40 years ago. It was after I finished my graduate work at the University of Colorado. I wandered in this overgrazed pasture in the town of Putney, Vermont, and came across a whole array of these very bonsai shrubs through continuous heavy grazing. I'm very good at plant identification. This one right here was only about 16 inches tall. It had leaves only about a half an inch long. And I was looking at it for 5 minutes trying to figure out what the heck species of plant this thing was. Baffled by it until I parted the deformed outer branches and could see some well-formed twigs. And when I did that, I saw the buds in those twigs had a white woolly coating, and I instantly realized I was looking at an apple tree. but in that way, it had been pretty heavily deformed by heavy browsing. So I wanted to figure out how old it was, how long it had been browsed. So I went home, I got a handsaw, I cut the 1 1/4-inch trunk of this bonsai apple. The annual growth rings were way too close together to count. I cut a section of the trunk off, took it home, sanded it down with a hand lens, realized the 16-inch high apple was 36 years of age. It was 10 years older than I was at the time. And that amazed me. So I don't cut these anymore. I use an increment borer. I can take the core out of the trunk and age it. The oldest one I've gotten was one that was waist height in the state of New York at 94 years. So I'm pretty confident that somewhere in the Northeast, either now or maybe within the last few decades, there have been bonsai apples in overgrazed pastures no taller than this that are over a century of age and withstood sustained browsing through that time. Now, that's the only species I know of that can do that, that isn't armed with spines or thorns or is not impalatable. And this is probably an attribute apples develop in the old world, is what their strategy is. They can outweigh any livestock. They can just hang on until that patch becomes so unproductive, and then the livestock is pulled out, and then the apples bolt and grow into trees. Maybe after a century of not flowering, all of a sudden start flowering and fruiting and doing everything else. So this is an example of a pasture where the livestock had been pulled out about 3 years before the photograph was taken. Now, it just happens that this pasture in Vermont lay below an apple orchard. So apples would roll in the pasture, the cows would eat them and spread the seeds around. So every single broadleaf tree growing up in this pasture is an apple, every single one. But if you'll notice, they have a dense bonsai base down below, new growth shooting up, dense bonsai base, new growth shooting up. They're all like that. So if you go into an area like this, let's say 30 years after pasture abandonment, you'll have a young woodland. And in that woodland, you're going to encounter what I call weird apples. And I wish I'd come up with a better term than weird. I should have come up with something much more respectful, like maybe tenacious apples or something like that. But I wrote it, and it was my first book, and editors didn't touch it. And now it's actually become sort of a semi-technical term that other people use, so I have to sort of use it. But what a weird apple looks like if you're out in the woods, it's usually a multiple-trunked apple. Sometimes a single trunk, but in either case, from about waist height down to ground level, it's going to have rounded knobs on its trunk, and right at the base, a dense apron of dead branches skirting the tree. Whenever I see an apple like that around here or further north, I know I'm standing in a formerly overgrazed pasture. It's the only way to get the form like that. Now, the problem with weird apples is they're a fairly ephemeral piece of evidence, because apples are slow growing, and they're intolerant of being shaded. They get swallowed up in the canopy of the forest, and usually after, you know, 50 years or so, they die and rot away. the last time I encountered a weird apple in the field was 2006, and I'm beginning to think that's the last one I'll ever see. Because our last major period of pasture abandonment was the 1960s, and now we're looking at forests that are about 50 years of age, and all that evidence is fading. But luckily, there's another woody plant that's every bit as good as an indicator of overgrazed pastures, and that's the other woody plant in this slide, the common juniper. And right around here, we'll see a mixture of common juniper and eastern red cedar coming into sites like this. If you drive over to Canaan, going sort of the back way up to connect with Route 7, that little farm that's right as you go to the rise, the pastures near, you'll see a mixture of juniper and common juniper and eastern red cedar. But common juniper, if you're going to find it in most robust populations, it'll be in only one of four sites. It'll be in an overgrazed pasture like this. Another site you can find it are on rock, the crevices of rock outcroppings. In this case, a glacial boulder that has 1, 2, 3 clumps of juniper growing out of it. A third site you can find a lot of juniper is on very dry, sandy soils carpeted in mats of moss. So here's a young juniper here growing out of a mat of moss, some clumps of reindeer lichen. And then the last site you'll find it are in power line cuts that are treated with herbicides. So if you're gonna find a lot of juniper, it's only gonna be in one of those four sites. And the reason is that juniper is very slow growing in its first 10 years of growth. and it's also very intolerant of being shaded, so it can only establish in sites that have little or no herbaceous growth. So you're not going to have much herbaceous growth in the crevice of a rock outcropping. You've got basically none here, a few whiffs of grass. In the power line cut, herbicides will kill that herbaceous growth. And in a pasture where livestock will crop around every single unpalatable juniper, they give them the chance to establish. So if you're out and about and you're not in a rock outcropping or on a mat of moss or in a power line cut, you see a lot of juniper, you're standing in an overgrazed pasture or an abandoned overgrazed pasture. So it's a very, very good indicator. Now, this is the same pasture as that last slide, but after pasture abandonment. And what I'd like you to focus on here is the diverse array of trees that have been nursed along by the shrubs in this pasture. And I should mention, common juniper is a great shrub to nurse along trees in a pasture because it hollows out in its interior and trees can seed in there. Now, you can't tell from the slide, but if you were to walk into this pasture at the time the shot was taken, you would be able to come across red maple, sugar maple, paper birch, yellow birch, black birch, white ash, black cherry, red oak, beech, aspen, white pine, a very diverse array growing out of these nurse shrubs. Whenever I walk into a young forest that I know has followed pasture abandonment, the very first thing I do is I just look at the canopy of that woodland. If it's very diverse the way this is going to be, that tells me that pasture was overgrazed a long time and developed lots of nurse shrubs. However, if I walk into a young forest that followed pasture abandonment, that there were no shrubs in place at time of abandonment, that forest will come into a monoculture of just one species of tree. I've seen sites where it's just all sugar maple. I've seen sites where it's all white ash, all white pine. So the difference is the presence or absence of nurse shrubs has a big impact on the forest that follows, and also the fact that many of our native tree species have developed a strategy called masting. And what masting is, we can use red oaks for this because they're masting up our way, and they may be masting down here as well. We'll see that when we're out in the woods today. But what masting is, all the red oaks in a region, and it could be a region as big as the southern half of New England, will coordinate when they're going to produce acorns. So for a number of years in a row, they won't be producing hardly any acorns at all. And all the energy that can be going into acorn production is being stored as starch in the roots of the trees. And it might be, 4 years later, it might be 6 years later, who knows. And then they all at the same time mobilize that energy and come forth with a bumper crop of acorns. So during a mast year for oaks, if you're walking out in an old woodland, it's like walking on marbles. There's just acorns everywhere. And many, many, many of our tree species have developed this strategy. So if you have nurse shrubs in a pasture, let's say that oak is masting 1 year, they're going to seed into the nurse shrubs. Let's say the next year it's beech and sugar maple that are masting, they will seed in. The next year is ash and white pine, they will seed in. And after about a decade, you have this very diverse array of trees growing out. But if the pasture's abandoned before any nurse shrubs are in place, whatever nearby tree is masting is going to carpet that pasture in seeds and it's going to come up into a monoculture.
Does anyone know whether there's any communication between the trees or are they just
right. I think we have to assume the question is do we know if there's communication between the trees or is it just luck that they all happen to do at the same time? I think we have to assume that there is. There's strong belief there is communication, and there's two reasons for this. One, the oaks on Martha's Vineyard, Nantucket, in coastal Massachusetts, although all in the same growing climate, so growing climate ellipse is what coordinates the area of masting, are all on three different masting schedules. And the feeling is they're too far apart to coordinate and communicate. Yes?
Would that be like mycorrhizal?
Well, we do know there is communication via mycorrhizal, but this can happen over great distances. So it's probably not mycorrhizal. Now, it might sound odd that trees communicate, but a study was done in 1981 at Penn State University that showed communication in red oaks. At that time, we were being really hammered up here by gypsy moth defoliations in our oak woodlands. Well, researchers at Penn State University wanted to figure out how quickly oaks could mobilize the tannin in their leaves to to ward off herbivory, because that's a chemical that really makes it hard for herbivores to tolerate. So they didn't have any gypsy moth down there. This is an experiment. So they had a group of experimental oak trees. Each of those oaks, they took off a leaf at the start of the experiment to test the tannin levels. And then each day, they went up those trees and ripped up the leaves in little tiny pieces as if they're being eaten by a gypsy moth. And then each day would take off an intact leaf, check its tannin levels, and sure enough, once they started that treatment, the tannin levels started really skyrocketing. But being good researchers, they had another group of oaks that were the control trees. With those, at the start of the experiment, they took off one leaf of each of those trees, tested it. Both groups, the experimental and the control, had pretty much the same tannin loading. Then they never touched those trees again, just taking off one leaf each day of the experiment of the control trees, and the control trees started boosting their tannin levels at the exact same rate. The two populations were separated by a highway system or half a mile apart. So they quickly realized it wasn't through mycorrhizal communication in that case. They thought, all right, when we rip up the leaves, some sort of plant hormone is being released as an aerosol, and they quickly pin it down as jasmonic acid. So if oaks get defoliated, they do release jasmonic acid, and it starts alerting other oaks to boost tannin levels. So the belief is that the same thing is probably happening with the coordinating mast.
I can't figure out what is the advantage of masting.
We'll hold on. I'm going to come right back to that, but there's two other questions.
No, that was the same question.
Okay, maybe one right back here.
I was just going to mention the maple and ash. About 8 years ago, there was a carpeting of maple seed, and then 2 years ago, there was a real thick ash release of seed.
Yeah.
Filled the gutters.
Yeah. I mean, and those would be masters. Now, they will produce some seed in between. But they do mast as well, and when that happens in your forest understory, you almost get a lawn of one species.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So that has something to do with the ash suffering, and that it was saying, okay, now it's time to send out our progeny.
Well, what it is, if trees do get stressed, they have a level of cognizance that is basically alerting them, you know, I might not be around much longer, maybe I need to get my seeds out now.
Yeah.
But when you have it regionally throughout an area, that's not that stress, that's just the masking strategy. So the question is, why do they do this? If you think about it, from an individual tree's perspective, this is a chancy proposition. Let's say you're an oak and you've been storing energy in your roots for 5 years, and next year's going to be the mast year. But that winter, you get knocked down in a wind event, or your canopy gets ripped apart in an ice storm, or you get cut down a logging event, and you've lost all that reproductive potential. Since this is a gamble, why have so many of our tree species developed this strategy? Why does it work for them? That's the
better
first part
chances.
Of the question. Is that?
Better chances.
Yeah.
For an oak in general.
But why? You're right.
Because they won't all be grazed, or they won't all be insect
eaten. Exactly. So this is a strategy to thwart seed consumers. All right, so here's the...
The turkey.
No. So that's, you're anticipating it, but I just say, what is the major consumer of acorns that's not the turkey?
Squirrels.
Not squirrels.
Deer?
Chipmunk. Not deer.
Chipmunks.
Not chipmunks or any rodent. Not
people.
Not people.
Insects.
Birds.
Not birds.
Rabbits.
Insects.
Not rabbits. Yes, you're getting close. I heard insects. It is the larvae of the acorn weevil. Now, I've never seen an acorn weevil. They're a very small insect that hangs out in the canopy of oak trees. And in July, they're laying one egg into each acorn they can find. And that egg hatches out in the larvae and starts eating the meat of the acorn. Now, the larvae doesn't consume the whole acorn, but it usually consumes enough to destroy the viability of the acorn. And then when the acorn comes down to the ground, there's plenty left for all the mammals and birds. So if you've ever seen that little clean hole in the shell of an acorn, that's the exit hole of the acorn weevil. So if all the oaks in a region can depress acorn production a number of years in a row, they really suppress the weevil population and overwhelm them in the mast year. It's such a great strategy for oaks. The studies have shown, if you see an oak in the canopy of the forest around here, you can be 99% sure it was spawned in a mast year. So that means our masting trees, like oak, come in age class cohorts during masting years. And of course, there's a lot of speculation I mentioned that they have to communicate to coordinate this. It's like, it's next year, right? Your hills. If I'm gonna be in this with all you guys, I don't wanna produce all my acorns, but none of you are, and the weevils will just get them. So we do have that speculation. Now, this was the 2001 mast year for white pine in central New England. It was a massive mast year. The pines were so loaded with cones and cone cases, their branches started cracking off, and the branches were bent way under the weight. That was in our woodland in Vermont. I didn't like pile those cones up like that. They just fell like that. They were like that throughout the forest. It was quite amazing. Yeah.
So white pines don't produce any cones except in the mesmeral?
I mean, they might have a cone here or there, but very, very few. Very, very few. And then when the masting year comes, they're just loaded. So if any one of you have, let's say, pines in your yard, you'll know when a masting year is, but all of a sudden, the next year, there's cones all over the ground. Like, well, I haven't seen these for a while, and they're just there.
So how often do they mast?
You can't predict masting schedules. So they're not on a regular cycle, because if they were, then their prey would figure that out. So they come irregularly, but generally, you'll have, like 2001 was the last masting cycle, was one I just mentioned. The next one was 2009, and then 2013, so it was 8 years and four. But they come in irregular, bits of times you can't predict. Yeah.
That you know, does anyone track masting years in this region?
I'm sure probably someone is. I mean, I sort of keep a mental note of species in my head. I'd probably be really smart just to really track it and write it down and stuff. But I'm sure that people do that. So some cases where you get juniper in an overgrazed pasture, it'll grow up to be continuous seed. And now you can see all the trees that have been nursed along by it. Eventually, their crowns will touch. And because juniper is not tolerant of being shaded, it's going to die. But luckily, juniper has very rot-resistant resinous branches, so skeletal remains can be easily identifiable 50 years after the shrub dies. But after about 75 years of forest development, weird apples, common juniper will no longer be there, which means any pastures abandoned around the time of World War II or earlier, this evidence is gone. And since the vast bulk of our pastures already abandoned by that point, we can't use this. So you have to go for longer lasting evidence. So what I go for next are what I call pasture trees. And a pasture tree has two attributes. The first is, like this hemlock, it's a tree that grew by itself and spread out low, big branches far and wide. So it's an open-grown tree, there's nothing that's growing around it. That's the first attribute. The second attribute, that it's not growing in a fence line. This hemlock has no barbed wire attached to it, it's not growing out of a stone wall. In fact, this tree is growing at the top of a small hill that around the base is inscribed by stone and wire fencing. When I see a tree like that out in the middle of a once open agricultural landscape, I know I'm looking at pasture. A tree like this would not have been left in a crop field, would make plowing and growing crops difficult. A tree like this, particularly a hemlock, with its dense shade of winterfall, would not have been left in a hay field, where it would have reduced the productivity of growing a hay, but it would have been left in a pasture to offer shade to livestock on hot summer days. Now, the problem with pasture trees is that because they grow so much outwardly initially, they can never attain the height of the forest that grows up around them. And eventually, they're going to be swallowed up in the canopy of that forest, and if they're not shade tolerant like this hemlock, they're going to die and rot away. So actually, if we could go out in the woodlands around here, let's say 100 years ago, we would find many, many more specimens of pasture trees than we see today. A lot of them have already been gone, and I'm guessing in another century, we won't find them at all, which will be a shame because these sort of large legacy trees that we have in our forests are also an ephemeral bit of evidence, and eventually they won't be there. And it'll sort of change the characters of our forest. So lack of a pasture tree doesn't mean you might not be in an old abandoned pasture, it just means to look further. And what I go for next is fencing. If I get wire fencing, that gives me a lot of information right off the bat. If it's barbed wire, like it is here, that tells me I'm looking at pastures that held cows or horses, but not sheep. Sheep with their heavy fleece can't feel the barbs of barbed wire. They can get caught and tangled and hurt in the fencing, so farmers didn't use barbed wire with sheep. Secondly, it tells me I'm looking at a pasture that was worked after 1874, 1874 is the very first year that wire is produced commercially for fencing. And thirdly, if the wire is attached to small fence posts or trees, by small I mean 3 or 4 inches in diameter or less, then you can tell on which side of that fence the pasture occurred. Now, this right here is a red maple. When I took the photograph, it was 6 inches in diameter. Generally at that size, a red maple would have smooth gray bark. This tree is quite a bit older than you might think, given its size. It's slow growing, because the bark's already furrowing. I also know it takes at least 25 years before wire gets surrounded by the wood of a growing tree. So I'm pretty confident this wire was strung up and this tree was only about 3 inches in diameter. And because of that, I can now tell on which side of this fence the pasture existed. So I want you to think about this. If you're nailing up wire on the small trees or posts, are you going to put on the side that's facing the pasture or on the side facing away from the pasture?
Facing, yes.
And that's because if the livestock are leaning into the wire, they're pushing it into the tree or the post. If it's on the far side, they can actually dislodge it and knock the wire down and then get out. Now, if you're attaching it to big trees where you can anchor big nails, you can put it on whatever side is convenient. But if it's on small stock, you got to put it on the side facing the pasture. So the pasture was out here. Behind the other side wasn't a budding woodlot in this case. Now, this is a common view, a stone fence running out through our woodlands. This is up in Vermont. There's no wire associated with this fence, so the best guess is this was abandoned between 1845 and 1855. More land was abandoned in Vermont to grow back to forest in that 10-year time frame than any other 10-year time frame since. So if I get a fence like this, I'm going to walk it to see if I can find many small fist-sized rocks associated with the fence. Any fence that has a decent amount of small fist-sized rocks associated with it means that it abutted crop fields where the ground was plowed every year and rocks were removed. Now, any of you that have vegetable gardens around here, if you're not down into the Housatonic floodplain soils, but you're up on glacial tills, you'll know every spring when you turn your garden soil over, there's a whole new crop of rocks there when you thought you cleaned them all out the year before. And you might think, God, what do these things do? Reproduce or something? And yet we don't have rocks surfacing out of our lawns. We don't have rocks surfacing out of woodlands. It's only in sites that lack perennial root vegetation. Because the roots of perennial plants, whether they're grasses or trees or shrubs, stitch everything in the soil together as a unit. So when the ground freezes and expands in the winter and then thaws and settles in the spring, rocks are locked in place. But in a garden or crop field where those roots aren't there, freeze and thaw cycles lift up rocks about an inch a year, moving them up to the surface. And the way this works is, imagine a rock down the ground, the frost layer comes down, hooks onto the rock, and then the frost continues down below the rock, the ground's expanding, so the rock is being lifted as the ground expands. What people don't realize is, when the thaw commences at the end of winter, it doesn't come from the top down, it comes from the bottom up. Because around here, when we get down below the frost zone, we're in the soil temperatures in the upper 50s. There's an incredible heat reservoir down there. So as the winter abates and the cold can't get down as far anymore, that heat zone starts migrating up. The pocket where the rock was thaws, collapses a bit, while the rock is still held in the frozen ground. And when it's released, it can never quite make it back to its starting point. So every year, they're ratcheted up about an inch a year, and they get to the top, they get picked out to make way for sowing seed. And of course, if there's already a stone fence nearby, then they get incorporated in that fence. Around here, you can see a lot of that. If you drive Inter Mountain Road, Route 41, up through Salisbury here and up through Sheffield, take a look at the stone walls on the side of the road. It's just loaded with small rock. That was all crop field on both sides going all the way up towards Egremont.
I used to live in down in Weston, and they used to have rocks in pasture. The pasture was still there, but they had these deep holes in them. You know, they looked like they were drilled. You know, someone said they used to pour water in them, and pour them or something.
Well, I mean, if let's say, I know in areas in Vermont where granite is rare, if glaciers drop granite boulders, that was like a gift, because that would, they would quarry them. It's very easy to quarry them. They'd quarry them up for lentils over doors and windows or foundation stones and stuff. So I don't know the type of rock that you're talking about, but if it was granite, that was commonly drilled and cored and quarried.
My assumption was to get the rock out of the pasture.
It could be that, but it may have been they're pouring it actually for material.
Oh, okay.
Because if they're really big rocks, they often weren't going to waste their time trying to move it. Really big boulders usually just left in the pasture. So if they're going to take the effort to quarry them, they're probably taking for the stone itself. And I should mention, I encountered a site down in Washington, Connecticut that was really, really intriguing, because actually this woman had a son, pretty precocious guy, who loved reading the forested landscape. He was only about 11 years old, and he said, "We've got to get Tom Wessels down here. We've got to get him down here." So his mom actually got me down to walk their property. Because he had discovered these anomalous holes in the woods up behind their farmhouse. And he wanted me to come down and interpret them. So we got up to the first one. It's just a big depression in the ground. I could see that something had been excavated, but it wasn't for a dug well. I'm looking at this and thinking, what the heck is this? And I'm absolutely perplexed. I've never seen anything like this. Went further and did a series of them. All of a sudden, there were milky quartz shards all around the outside. And then I realized what was going on. Milky quartz often has silver veins in it. And whoever was on that farm was taking these glacial boulders that had been dropped in their property and pouring them for the silver. But that's the only time I've ever seen that. But those are sort of anomalous quarried sites in that regard. Now in this case, if you walk this stone fence, you'll never find a single small fist-sized rock. Not a one. So that tells us neither side was ever a crop field. So now we're left, well, gee, was it hay field or was it pasture? What is your guess looking at the slide? Pasture. And why is that? Yeah, it's very steep, irregular, rocky ground. The stone fence just about disappears there. It's a really steep downslope. Really, really steep. Outcroppings of ledge back here. This is not a suitable site for growing or scything hay, but more than suitable for grazing sheep. So by simply looking at stone wall construction in the surrounding lay of the land, you can often interpret whether you're looking at pasture, hay field, crop field. Yeah.
Now, the size of the wall seems quite inadequate to hold sheep. Has that wall deteriorated in its height?
Combination of things. So, generally, stone fences would come up to waist height. One thing to lift rocks like this, quite another to something like that. Now, there was a couple of different forms of Reno sheep. There was one breed that was extremely short-legged. And you could get by with a 3-foot wall with those guys. But the bulk of the sheep were not the short-legged variety. They were taller-legged or longer-legged. And so, towns that had good populations of Reno sheep in New England also had fence wardens or fence viewers. Our town of Westminster, Vermont, that we just moved out of, still has a fence warden. But that individual is nowhere near the clout they used to have. I used to razz the guy about it, saying, golly, if you were fence warden back in the 1820s, you'd be the most powerful position in town. Because what the position of fence warden was, towns would set minimum border fence heights. In the town of Westminster, it was 4.5 feet, and Putnam was 5 feet. The fence warden or fence viewer would have a staff exactly that length. They would come unannounced and walk the boundary run of a farm. If anywhere along the run it dropped below that minimum height, that was grounds for a very serious fine. It was levied right on the spot. And I know in our town of Westminster, the Historical Society records tell me that our fence warden back in the sheep fever period, Westminster didn't just do that. He went right to the pastor to tell him what happened, and the next Sunday, that farm was brought up in front of the parish he made an example of. Now, it sounds harsh, but many of these farms had thousands of sheep, and if their flocks got out of their pastures into an abutting farm grain fields, they could devastate those grain fields in minutes. So this is the way to keep the peace. Now, since the walls only came up, generally with stone, to about 3 feet, they'd get up to the 4.5 or 5 foot mark by taking poles and putting a rail across the top, cross poles with a rail, and that would be adequate. So But they have fallen down too, but generally waist height was the rule for a stone fence.
So to that, so people are stealing stones off these fences?
No, they're not. Now that definitely happened, but not in this case. You know, they are falling down. You see rock that's fallen down here and here and here because of freeze and thaw cycles.
Okay.
Soil is built up around the base, so yeah, they've diminished, not because people are taking them, although that does happen. Yeah.
This doesn't have anything to really with the forest, but do you have any idea the kind of a workforce that it would take to create these types of structures?
Did the average farm have 10 people?
Or?
Yeah, our whole notion of physical labor is so different from what theirs was. We could not do this today. They grew up at young ages doing very heavy physical labor all day long. Now, at the age of 5, they're out there starting already. So their bodies were attuned to it. I can't imagine the amount of labor it took to cut down all these trees. It was all done with axes. They didn't have cross-cut saws. All done with axes. On the cow fields and hay fields, haul out all those stumps with oxen, remove all the stone, build up the stone walls, and be cutting with axe, you know, maybe 30 cords of wood every year. And this is all done outside your daily farm chores. I was giving a program up in St. Johnsbury, Vermont a couple years ago. We were talking about the amount of labor that people must have put in, how we can't even conceive of it today. And this older gentleman had brought the day book of his great-great-great-great-great-great-grandfather. He said, I just want to read a passage. And I said, sure, go for it. He goes, okay. So he read it, and then the passage went, walk to Danby today, cut 5 cords of wood, and walk home for dinner. Danby was 20 miles away. He walked 20 miles, cut 5 cords of wood with an axe, and then walked 20 miles home. That was a day's work. I mean, it's hard to imagine doing that. But they obviously can do things we just can't do. All right, this is actually a photograph taken right up on one of those stone walls along Route 41 in Sheffield. The lens cap here, only about 2 inches in diameter, a lot of rocks in here the size of large potatoes. Certainly not the type of material you'd choose to make a stone wall with. It's just telling us a lot of rock came out of those fields that were small and just got incorporated into the walls. So again, if you have a lot of small rock and walls, that's a great sign of cultivation. Now, if you get further east of here, and you start to get over into parts of eastern Connecticut, Rhode Island, eastern Massachusetts, New Hampshire, where a lot of great glacial boulders were dropped. Very classic crop field walls. There are 2 rows of big boulders set a few feet apart, and then the inside filled with small rock. You ever seen walls like that? That's a classic, classic crop field wall. All right, so this slide and the next one will, I think, end the slides. We won't have time really to get into interpreting forest histories in terms of logging. But we'll do that out in the field. Your task here is going to be to figure out what happened on the far side of this wall and what happened on the near side. And I'm going to give you some additional evidence to work with. So starting with the far side, this area over here is about a 5-acre parcel. It is pretty much surrounded by the stone fence we see in the foreground here. And the key piece of evidence is if we walk this stone fence all the way around that 5-acre parcel, we will never find a single small fist-sized rock anywhere, not a one. So you ought to be dropping one option off your list for this parcel over here based on that. Now, this side, I want to point out, this is the near side of that stone wall. There's just a lot of rock sticking out of the ground. These are not big glacial boulders or anything. So there's a rock there, one there, quartz rock, a rock, a rock, a rock, another rock, bunch more up in here. And yet, if we go back to that far side, we could walk this 5 acres and we will never see a single rock coming out of the ground. So based on all that, what do you think the far side was used for and what do you think the near side was used for? Yeah.
Grazing pasture on the far side and crop pasture on the close side.
Good guess, but not correct. Yeah.
Some kind of training area for...
No. No training.
Landed, so.
No.
Farming on one side.
Well, farming is general, so you have to be more specific.
Woodlot.
Crops, all right. Crops. Crops on neither side.
No
small rocks. Right, no small rocks. Yeah.
Hay or something that was keeping the stones down on the far side and grazing on the near side that was overgrazed and then eroded that allowed all the little stones to come up.
Yeah, you got it. That's exactly it. So hay field on this side, dramatically overgrazed and heavily eroded land on this side. So noticing this side, you'll notice that the ground is sloping down to the wall, but the surface is smooth and even. Any area we go out in here, if we're on glacial till soils, and the surface is smooth and even if it's sloping, that means it was plowed in the past and its pillows and cradles were removed by that plowing. So what pillows and cradles are is when live trees fall over in our forests, the roots rip out of the ground, excavating what's called a pit or a cradle. And then you have the down tree with the upturned roots and the excavated earth in those roots. And when those roots rot, that earth is dropped to form a mound or a pillow. So you have what's called pit and mound, or pillow and cradle topography. Large pillows and cradles can be visible in our forests for up to a millennium. And with our very robust disturbance range gene here from windstorms, from both thunderstorm microbursts as well as hurricanes, and also wet snow and ice loading events, after a couple of centuries, our glacial till soils in our forests just get covered with pillows and cradles. So if you come on something like this and they're not there, that means they've been removed. They've been removed by plowing. Now, farmers plow for two reasons. One was to create crop fields. And crop fields were plowed every year, keeping them free of perennial root vegetation. Now, something else that the British were amazed by when they first came here were our soils. Their first plowing, so those soils, was not bringing up any rock. And they were just shocked by this, coming from Great Britain, where there's rock everywhere. Because our soils had been developing for thousands of years. And any critters in the soil, excavating material on the surface, were only bringing up fine material. Look what ants bring up. Look what moles bring up. They don't bring up rocks or gravel. They just bring up soil. So after all that time, the rock in our glacial till soils was buried under a foot or more of very clean soil. So when they, would plow, God, nothing was coming up. They thought that was great. But after about a decade in those crop fields, all of a sudden the rocks started pouring out of the ground like out of a cornucopia. They probably thought, God, what sins did we create to get this business upon us? So here, they would have plowed this just a few times to get rid of the pillows and cradles. Once it was leveled out, they would have seeded it. And if it was well cared for, they might have plowed again. Originally, this would have had zigzag slip rail fencing around it. Eventually, that rotted away, and there's no longer enough wood. They brought in big rocks to build the fencing. And then on this side, we probably lost a foot of soil due to erosion from overgrazing. The only way you can normally get small rocks like this in the surface of a forest soil, there's only three ways this can happen. If you have a ledge nearby and small rock cleaves off and migrates downslope, well, it'll sit at the top of the soil. A second way is if you have, in the springtime, saturated soils where water's running over the surface, it can erode down exposing rocks and then dry up. And then the last way is that often trees will bring up rocks in their roots when they're knocked over by wind or snow or ice loading, but then the rocks will only be found on pillows. None of that's happening here. We don't have any ledge nearby. We have no saturated soils. The rocks are ubiquitous everywhere. They're not just on pillows. The only explanation is we've lost about a foot of soil from overgrazing during the sheep fever period. Now, this is a lot of stuff to remember that I've gone through. Here's the takeaway. If you want to impress your friends or neighbors, you can stop in the woods anywhere around you and stop and say, you know, we're standing in a former pasture. You'll be correct 75% of the time. So just remember that. But if you want a closer read, this is some sort of evidence that you look at. We'll be looking at this out in the field. So I think we have time for maybe about 5 to 10 minutes of questions, and I think we'll break for lunch. But yeah.
Wasn't the layer of duff, the leaf litter, just very fine particles of soil up to a foot thick? Wasn't that one of the factors why it was so easily eroded?
The duff layers, it depends on our forest sites. Now, if you get into pitch pine barrow woodlands, like we can find pitch pine woodlands up on the knobs of Botanics here. If you get into areas where they're pretty productive, they can make duff layers that are a foot to 18 inches deep. And Actually, those are only sites that will naturally get lightning struck fire. So Mount Everett, back probably about 12 or 13 years ago, had a lightning struck fire on the eastern side. What happens, the lightning hits, it sparks way down the duff smolders, and then eventually comes up. But in our forest, like around here, where we're down on these very rich, low-grade marble-derived soils, the duff layers don't get very deep because the material's so decay-prone. It decays down to humus very, very quickly.
Well, so I guess that's what I should have said. The duff has been converted to humus, but since it hadn't been disturbed in a fairly long time, except by the Indians burning it.
Yeah, they would just probably burn just along the river mostly.
Right, you got a decent layer of this rich humus, which
you do,
was very productive to begin with.
You do, but also even that humus might have only been, maybe that thick.
Okay.
You still have, rock-free areas going down quite a bit below it because of all this excavation material, mineral material up to the surface.
By the critters.
By the critters.
Wow.
Yeah.
Most of